Good morning, Church. We have been studying in Romans how there is present suffering because we live in a fallen world. But God has promised future glory. And keeping this in view enables us to persevere any suffering with hope. So while we patiently wait, let us start or continue getting ready by using our bodies as living sacrifices of worship and instruments of righteousness for the glory of God. This morning, let us give praise to God because He gives us certainty of the future glory that gives us hope to persevere through the setbacks of life.
Oh, center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus at the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus be the center of my life. Jesus be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, Jesus be the center, it's all about you, yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens. Jesus be the center, it's all about you, yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens. Jesus be the center, it's all about you, yes, it's all about you, from my heart to the heavens. Jesus be the center, it's all about you, yes, it's all about you. Jesus be the center of your church. Jesus be the center of your church. And every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess you, Jesus. Jesus. Sacrifice.
Happy Sunday, dear brothers and sisters in Christ. I'm glad that we are still here to be able to worship the Lord each and every Sunday. So join me as we come to the Lord in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, all glory and honor, praise and praise belong to you. You are worthy of all our adoration. We are grateful for this privilege of being able to come into your holy presence. We thank you for sacrificing your Son, Jesus Christ, for us to be delivered from the bondage of sin. By his blood, you have cleansed us from all our unrighteousness. We are eternally indebted for what Jesus has done at the cross. Align our hearts with yours, that we may do what you have purposed us to be. Teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Please make us receptive to your word. May your Holy Spirit guide your messenger, that he may speak in truth with your power. Let your word renew our mind and help us be transformed into your likeness as we walk by faith each day of our remaining life here on earth. Father, we remember those who are badly affected by this pandemic. We pray for those who lost a loved one. You alone can understand their pain. We pray for those who lost their jobs and those who are suffering with anxiety and depression. Even in the midst of trouble, let your love sustain their hope. And may your peace that passeth all understanding fill their hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Let them find help from people around them. Lord God, we also pray for our country. Let your mercy reign upon this nation. Forgive us for not honoring you. Please give us leaders who will love and serve the people with honor and dignity. Help us choose the one you have chosen, and may your will be done for the future of the next generation. In Christ's most precious name, we ask all these things with thanksgiving. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome to Lighthouse of Faith Tabernacle. Once again, we're very happy that you can join us in our worship service for this morning. If you're looking at our screen today, we are now discussing the topic entitled Love and Truth. And for many of you, you may look at this picture and say that this is very familiar. Well, this is very familiar because this is the same picture and the title that I used a few weeks ago when we talk about love and truth. But the difference is, last time we were talking from 2 John, and today we'll be looking at 3 John. Now, there are many similarities between 2 John and 3 John. The use of words like truth and love abound in both letters. Both were written by someone calling himself to be the elder. We know that this is actually Apostle John. We have discussed this last time. And 3 John is actually the shortest letter with only about 14 verses in the New Testament. It's the shortest letter. But when you go through 3 John, as much as it is very much reminiscence of 2 John, you will understand that there are also a lot of differences between 2 John and 3 John. For one thing, 2 John didn't mention any names, while 3 John, the Apostle John, would actually mention three particular names in this very short letter. We will be looking at the three men mentioned in this book this morning. But before we go on, let's try to look at more differences between these two books. In 2 John, the Apostle Paul was writing the chosen lady and her children. We talked about this last time. But when we come to 3 John, he was no longer writing to a lady and her children, but he was writing to a friend by the name of Gaius. Gaius is a very common name during those times. In fact, if you go through the Bible has actually five, the name Gaius actually appeared five times in the New Testament. Most scholars believe that these five references may not be the same person. Okay, maybe two or three references might be the same person, but the rest are not. Probably only the Gaius of Romans chapter 16 could be connected to the Gaius of 3 John. But even in this regard, scholars aren't really sure that this is one and the same person. Well, another main difference in between these two books is in the book of 2 John, we understand that Apostle John was writing in order to tell the lady and her children to learn to be hospitable, to accept these traveling pastors in. The book of 2 John was telling this lady and her children that they are being too hospitable and they should not be opening their doors to just anyone, but they have to balance their love with the truth. It is good that they are loving and they allow any preachers to come into their house and receive them, but they have to be careful that they balance this with truth, because some of those preachers are actually not teaching according to the scriptures. Some of those teachers are even teaching false teachings. And that's why the Apostle John was warning the lady, you are being too hospitable. You are to balance your love with truth. And when we come to 3 John, it may seem to be contradicting each other, because in 3 John, he was now telling Gaius, the church is not being hospitable. Not Gaius himself, but the church. The church is not being hospitable. And truth is not balanced with love. Yes, there are people who are living in the truth. There are people who talks about the truth, teaches the truth, and studies the truth, but they are not balancing it with love. At least one person in the church is not doing so. And it may seem that these two books are actually contradicting each other, but we need to, rather than seeing them as contradicting each other, we need to rather see both letters as completing each other. Let's go to our passage this morning. 3 John, verse 1 to 2 says, the elder, again, it was written by the elder, to my friend Gaius, whom I love in the truth. If you remember 2 John, very similar. I love you in the truth. And he goes on to talk about his prayer for this friend Gaius. Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health and that all may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along well. John was concerned not just about the physical aspect of this person, but more importantly, the spiritual aspect of this person. And that's why he was praying a holistic prayer, that the Lord will grant him good health as well as a good spiritual well-being. But here's where we want to focus on in the next few verses. In verse 3 to 4, John says, it gave me great joy to have some brothers come and tell about your faithfulness to the truth, and how you continue to walk in the truth. I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. He goes on to say, dear friend, you are faithful in what you are doing for the brothers, even though they are strangers to you. They have told the church about your love. You will do well to send them on their way in a manner worthy of God. Now, in this four verses, the Apostle John gave us a little background on who Gaius is, okay, on what kind of a person Gaius was. The first thing he mentioned was that Gaius was committed to the truth. He was someone who, upon entering into the truth, upon becoming a believer, he gave his life to understanding the truth. He was reading the scriptures, he was knowing the scriptures, he didn't stop learning about the truth. He committed his life for the purpose of knowing the scriptures, very much like the Pharisees. If you remember, we discussed about the Pharisees on how they invested their whole lives into learning the law. Gaius was that kind of a person. He loved the truth. He studied the truth. He committed himself and became faithful to the truth. But that it does not end there. The second thing that Apostle John was saying was that I am very thankful, I'm very grateful that you continue to walk in the truth. In fact, John says, there is no greater joy for me to see my children walking in the truth. And John was actually recommending or praising Gaius for continually walking in the truth. When we became Christian, all of us entered into the truth. But we need to continue in the truth. You see, all of us are in the truth. If we are a believer, then we are in the truth. But not everyone continues in the truth. Some people stop growing. Some people stop learning the truth. You see, for Gaius, he was not simply holding on to the truth, but he was also continually walking in the truth. He wanted to live a life that reflects the truth that he is learning. unlike the Pharisees, who became hypocrites because although they knew the truth, they were not walking according to the truth. Gaius, however, he knew the truth and continued to make sure that his life would be lived in accordance to the truth. And that's why the Apostle John ended by telling us that Gaius exemplifies love for others. He opened his house for these itinerant preachers, these traveling preachers, and opened his house to welcome them in. Even though these preachers were strangers to him, he didn't care. He wanted to show his love for these people. He wanted to show that he is someone who knows the truth and continues to live out the truth. He exemplified his love even to strangers. Hebrews chapter 13 verse 2 gives us a very beautiful reminder. It says, "Do not forget to entertain strangers, for by so doing, some people have entertained angels without knowing it." Gaius understood that. He understood that these preachers were coming into his community. You see, during those times, we have to understand the situation. These traveling preachers, when they leave their church, when they leave their city, they would go to a new city. Remember, during those times, the church was just new. And there were so many cities that didn't know Jesus Christ. There were so many cities that still do not have a church. And so these traveling pastors would go around. We would call them missionaries probably today. They would go around these different cities preaching the gospel there. They would spend 1 or 2 months or 3 months teaching the people the truth there before moving on and starting another church somewhere else. The problem is, when these people go to a certain land, the reality is they don't have much finances. They don't have much support, because that community didn't know Jesus Christ. Most of them are pagans. And so the Apostle John says, it is good for you to open your house for these traveling preachers. Look at what, and you open your house for them and welcome them in, and you continue to give them what they need so that the work may continue on. Look at verse 3 to 4 again. The Apostle John says, "It gave me great joy to have some brothers come and tell me about your faithfulness to the truth and how you continue to walk in the truth." Notice that some brothers came and tell me about your faithfulness. Gaius was not the one telling everyone that I'm opening my house. He was not bragging about what he's doing, much like the Pharisees were doing. He was simply doing what he is doing faithfully, and people sees him doing that. Look at the next few verses. "They have told the church about your love." They have told the church about your love. These people who've experienced the love of Gaius, these people who have experienced the hospitality of Gaius, they go around and tell others that Gaius was this kind of a person. And what I want to point out here is, people sees the hospitality and the love that you have for others. You don't have to brag about it. Look at Romans chapter 16, verse 23. "Gaius, whose hospitality I and the whole church here enjoy, sends you his greeting. Erastus," who is, forget about the second part. Now, understand, a few minutes ago, I told you that there are the name Gaius appeared 5 times in all of the New Testament. And this is one of them, Romans 16, 23. And it's very interesting to think about it. It's very interesting to think about this. Romans was written around 56 AD. 3 John was written somewhere around 80 to 90 AD. 56 AD, 80 to 90 AD. If the Gaius in Romans chapter 16, 23, who opened his house to receive Paul and his church, is the same Gaius that we find in 3 John, then do you know what that means? If in case this is the same person, then it means that for 3 decades, this Gaius continued to be hospitable, this Gaius continued to walk in love and truth. He continued on. Isn't that beautiful? if in case this is indeed the same Gaius, then he was someone who's very consistent. He was someone who continued on what he decided to be doing, to express the love of Christ through his hospitality. Now, let me tell you this, and this is something I want us to understand. Whether you know it or not, people around you are looking at how you live your life. Whether you know it or not, people around you are looking at how you live your life. So what does that mean? Well, if people are looking at your life, first, you don't have to brag about your works. You don't have to brag about your good works. You don't have to post everything you're doing on Facebook. Because if you're doing what's right, people will talk about it. If you're doing what's good, people will speak on your behalf. You don't have to toot your own horn. Someone will do it for you. Brothers and sisters, do not be like the Pharisees who love to toot their own horns. But rather, become like Gaius. He never bragged about what he was doing. It was the people who experienced his love who went around telling others what he was doing. You see, people are observing our lives. And that's why we don't have to brag about what we are doing. Secondly, observe long enough, people will see through your facade. Observe long enough, they will see through your facade. People are always observing what we are doing. And therefore, when people continue to observe long enough, our facade will break down. Our facade will break down, no matter how good you are at pretending. When you are observed long enough, people will know whether you are sincere or you're just simply faking it. My sisters, that's why I always say that if you want to know a person, if you want to know the person well enough, you don't talk to him, you don't talk to his friends. Rather, you talk to his maids at home. You talk to his employees, you talk to his drivers, you talk to his office mates at work. Because these are the people who have been with him for the longest period of time in a 24-hour day. They are the people who will see through every facade. They are the people who will see through the cracks. And they will be able to say whether you're really a sincere person in what you are doing and what you are saying. My sisters, when observed long enough, all your mask, all your facade, all your pretensions, they will fail. They will fail no matter how good you are at pretending. Third, because everyone is looking at our lives, you will either be a source of joy or disgust to people who hear about you. You will always be a source of joy or a source of disgust to people who hear about you. Let me ask you a question. How will people talk about you? Will you be presented as someone who is like Jesus? Will you be a source of encouragement to others, an inspiration to those who hears about you? Or will you be a warning to people? You see, our reputation always goes before us. Many times, our reputation muddies the gospel of the salvation that we preach. We become ineffective servants of God because we have a bad testimony, because we are full of pretensions. Brothers and sisters, our reputation always goes before us. People will not listen to what we have to say when they don't like what they see in our lives. You will be either a source of joy or a source of disgust to people who hear about you. Which will you be? Look at Gaius. It gave me great joy to have some brothers come and tell about your faithfulness to the truth. And I have no greater joy than to hear that my children are walking in the truth. Brothers, Gaius was a source of joy. He was a source of inspiration to many. Everyone who hears about his life is filled with joy, is filled with inspiration, hoping that they can be like Gaius. Is that the kind of life that you live? Gaius was a man who was faithful to the truth, who walked in the truth, and who continued to exemplify his love to others. Look at verse 5 to 6. This second part, it says, "They have told the church about your love. You will do well to send them on their way in a manner worthy of God." You see, during those times, there are two groups of teachers or pastors. One is what we call the settlers or the pastors, and the other is what we call the pioneers or the missionaries. You see, the pastors, let's start with the pioneers. The pioneers or the missionaries, they're the one who goes around cities to establish churches where there are no churches. They would go around, preach the word of God, and hopefully he could be able to start a church in that location. And when he's able to start a church there, he would train someone to be the pastor, the settler, someone who will stay with the church for the long haul. And then he would move on to another location. So we have two groups of people, the pioneers and the settlers. And this, as I mentioned, these pioneers, they don't have much support. So whenever they go to other cities, and sometimes they have to pass through one city before going to another city, the Apostle John is now saying, you know what? You will do well to send them on their way in a manner worthy of God. He's saying, if these people come upon you, if these traveling pastors, if these missionaries who come to you, accept them, provide for them, treat them in a way that you would treat God, in a manner worthy of God. Support their ministry. Why? Why should we support their ministry? Well, look at verse 7 and 8. It was for the sake of the name that they went out receiving no help from the pagans. We ought therefore to show hospitality to such men so that they may work together for the truth. So that we may work together for the truth. Now, notice what the Apostle John is saying first, and I would like to point this out very clearly. Christians should not expect help, or rather, Christians should not even accept help from the pagans. Why? Because the moment we accept help from the pagans, especially for the ministry, aren't we telling them in effect that we have a God who is not able to supply for our needs, and that's why we have to rely upon pagans? And that's why churches, we support missionaries because we don't expect the pagans to support them. You see, that's why I don't agree with Christians going up to a bus, preaching the gospel on the bus, and after preaching, he would go around with an envelope asking for money from the people in the bus. That's not what we ought to be doing. I don't agree with that principle. I don't agree with those people who would go to the public places and preach the gospel there and then would ask for donations from anyone that comes along. That's not how the scripture tells us to live our lives. In fact, if you go to the book of Corinthians, we are told that a pastor should receive double portion of what we are getting. The church should support the missionaries, the church should support their pastors. I'm not saying this so that the church would support me more, because honestly, the church is doing that already. But what I'm saying is we should not focus on receiving help from pagans, because to do so is to say that the God we are preaching to them is not able to provide. And this is a weak God that they would not want to hear of. So why do we go out and preach, and so why do we go out of our way to help these missionaries? Why do we go out of our way to help these people who are going around preaching the word of God? Well, it's very clear here. Verse 7 to 8 says, because they are doing this not for their own well-being. They were doing this for Jesus Christ, for the sake of the name. They were doing this for God. Even though they don't have any help from the pagans, they go out and do this at the risk of their lives. Secondly, why do we need to support them? Secondly, because we ought therefore to show hospitality to such men so that we may work together for the truth. Notice that we become partners with them when we are hospitable to them. We become partners in the ministry when we help them in their ministry. And that's why our church, I'm very blessed, because even before our church has a building fund, even before our church has a general fund, the first budget that we had was actually mission fund. And by the grace of God, every year, our mission fund has always been increasing, and we have never been short when it comes to our mission fund. Even though our building fund is not moving that fast, but by the grace of God, somehow we never are short with our mission fund. You see, when we help, when we support missionaries, we become partners with them in the work of the truth. You see, not many of us are called to be pastors. Not many of us are called to be missionaries. We cannot go out of our way to Timbuktu or to some other locations to preach the word of God there. Not all of us are called to do that. Not all of us are qualified to do that. And therefore, when we support missionaries to go there, we partner with them so that what they are doing there, the fruits that they have, is also our fruit. When we support missionaries, when we support people who are in the ministry, we become partners with them. And what fruit we have, what fruit those missionaries and those pastors have, it is also our fruit. I remember this beautiful song entitled Thank You for Giving to the Lord. If you had a chance to listen to that song, take time to listen to that song. It's a very beautiful song. One of the stanzas there tells us that, thank you for giving to the Lord. Because you gave, I am here in heaven today. That song basically saying, one day a missionary came to your church and asked for help, and you gave. And that's why I'm here in heaven today. Because you gave to that missionary, I am saved. And I am here today, and I want to thank you because you gave. And he's saying, and that song implies that, you know what? When we help missionaries, we're not just helping missionaries. We are investing in the souls of the people who potentially could come to know Jesus Christ. But before we go on, we need to once again be reminded of the warning of 2 John. Let us not forget what 2 John warned us about. Not everyone who claims to be a pastor deserves our help. We only help those pastors who are doing this for the name of Jesus Christ, not for personal gains. Because honestly speaking, there are so many pastors, there are so many missionaries who are out there just to enrich themselves. There are so many pastors and missionaries who are out there. Yes, they call themselves pastors. They pretend to be preaching, but their goal was not for the name of Christ, but for personal gains. So do not support this kind of missionaries. Secondly, we only help those pastors and missionaries who are teaching according to the truth of the scriptures. Don't support every missionary. Only support those who are actually faithful to the word of God. Because we have so many missionaries who are not preaching from the word of God. Who are not preaching the truth of the word of God. Again, the essential tenets of our faith, as long as they're teaching these three things, we are good. The Holy Trinity, the salvation by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, and salvation as the soul, as scripture as the sole authority of our godliness and life. As long as they're teaching these three things, then we should be good. When a pastor or a missionary doesn't teach these things, then don't support them. That's why it's very important for a church to have a relationship with the missionaries. That's why the church needs to know their missionaries. The Christians need to know those pastors they are supporting. Make sure that they are in the truth, or else, remember what I said, so that we may work together for the truth. You see, if you're supporting pastors who are not teaching the truth, if you are supporting pastors who are not teaching what is right, then guess what? you are also partner with him if you support him. You are partner with him in spreading falsehood. You are partner with him in making people condemned to eternity. Brothers, be careful about who we are supporting. Not every missionary, not every pastor deserves our help. Get to know them. Get to know their statement of faith before you actually step out and offer your help. Well, Diotrephes was one of those who didn't want to help. Look at 3 John chapter 9, verse 9. I wrote to the church, but Diotrephes, who loves to be first, will have nothing to do with us. Diotrephes, he loves to be first, and he doesn't want anything to do with us. Verse 10, so if I come, I will call attention to what he is doing, gossiping maliciously about us. Not satisfied with that he refuses to welcome the brothers, he also stops those who want to do so and puts them out of the church. Diotrephes is the opposite of Gaius. And here the Apostle John gives us a background on who Diotrephes is. Well, Diotrephes, by his name alone, means someone who is nursed by Jupiter. And the first description that the Apostle John had for him was that he was a man who is proud. He loves to be first. Remember the Pharisees we were talking about? Remember what the Bible says about them, what Jesus Christ says about them? They love the best seats. They love to be honored by the people. They love to be respected in public places. They love to be recognized. That's what Diotrephes is doing here. And the sad part is, Diotrephes is not one of those Pharisees who didn't know Jesus Christ. Diotrephes supposedly knew Jesus Christ, but somehow he is still someone who is focus on the self. And that's probably one reason why we believe he may not actually be a Christian, even though he is one of the leaders in the church. Because a Christian, his main goal is to glorify God, not to glorify the self. He loves to be first. I saw this on the internet, and I think this is a very important reminder for us. And the internet entitled this, How to Be Miserable. How to Be Miserable. Well, the first thing, according to the internet, if you want to be miserable, you have to only think about yourself. Keep thinking about yourself. In the end, you will end up very miserable. Secondly, talk only about yourself. Every conversation you have with other people, always talk about yourself. Don't talk about other things. Don't talk about others. You will end up miserable. Third, expect to always be appreciated. Always appreciated. When people don't appreciate you, demand that they appreciate you. Be suspicious of everyone. Be suspicious of everyone. Be entitled and demanding. You have to give me this. I deserve this. And lastly, second to the last, never forget, never forgive. You want to be miserable? Do not forget the sins of the people against you. And you will end up a miserable old man. When you don't know how to forget, when you don't know how to forgive, you will be one living with much anger, with much bitterness, and you will end up very miserable. And lastly, do nothing for others unless it benefits you. And if you look at this, this is the perfect description of Diotrephes. He loves to be first. He loves to be the one in the center of it all. He forgot what Jesus said in Luke chapter 9. Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves. A disciple of Christ is not someone who looks out always for number one. A disciple of Christ is someone who knows how to give up his rights, how to give up his privileges for the better, for the good of everyone. Diotrephes, he loves to be first. Not only did he love to be first, you see, when pride comes in, the next thing that happens is criticism. When you are proud, you start criticizing others. John says this person started gossiping about them, giving up derogatory words to destroy the authority of John the Apostle. And John said, when I come, I will call attention to what he's doing. I will call him out. I will reprimand him. I will rebuke him. But that's the problem. When you are someone who is proud, you feel that you are better than everyone else. And that's why you end up criticizing everyone. Isn't that what the Pharisees were doing? They were proud and they were criticizing and judgmental of everyone else. Thirdly, look at what he did. Diotrephes started isolating himself. In fact, he isolated the church from everyone else. He rejects those traveling preachers coming in. Why? Well, there are many reasons. One of those reasons that I see is because when you have a traveling preachers coming to stay with your church, it can funnel out your finances very fast. Because you have to support this missionary, you have to give him a place to stay, you have to give him food to eat, you have to provide for his needs for the next trip. And it can easily use up the resources of the church. And that's why some people become very protective of his turf. And I have to remind us, especially for me as a pastor, the church is not my turf. The church is God's turf. The moment I start thinking of the church as my turf, that the resources of the church is my resources, then something is very wrong with me. Something is very wrong with me. You see, this person, Diotrephes, he started isolating himself. Well, if you only love yourself, of course, you will see, and you start criticizing others, of course, you'll see others lesser than you are. And why on earth would you want to be among people who are lesser than you? And so what did he do? He started isolating himself. And here's the problem. Because when you isolate yourself from the rest of the community, the Christian community, when you isolate yourself from the rest of the churches around you, no one will be able to correct you when you are falling astray. No one will be able to teach you when you are teaching wrong. No one will be able to rebuke you. I'm glad that as a pastor, I'm a member of the Filipino-Chinese church community or the Filipino-Chinese pastors community. Because in the Filipino-Chinese Filipino-Chinese Christian church, words travel very fast. So the moment I start preaching something that is not in accord with the Bible, pastors will start calling me and rebuking me. I have them who holds me accountable. The problem is when you isolate yourself, you get rid of all these accountability partners. So that when you are now doing something wrong or when you are teaching what is wrong, no one will be there to correct you. No one will be there to reprimand you because you have isolated yourselves. Someone once said, always having to come first or always having to be first comes at a high relational cost. The first thing that happened when you continue to focus on the self is that all your relationships will be destroyed. All your relationships will suffer. And you will end up isolating yourself. Brothers and sisters, be careful. When people rebukes you, when people corrects you, don't run away from them. Don't turn a deaf ear on them. Learn to listen. Yun yung problema because a lot of times, we don't like to listen to criticisms. We don't like to listen to rebukes. When people rebuke us, we turn a deaf ear. We turn the other way and walk the other way. And the problem is, we never learn, we never grow. We never get back into the right path. The sad part with Diotrephes is that he did not only end with isolation, but he came to the point that he became a dictator. Remember, as I said, he was a leader in the church. And as such, he started preventing others from doing what is right. He prevented others and dictated upon others. Do not accept any traveling pastors. Do not allow them to come into your houses. when the church didn't want to receive them, these pastors turned to other Christians, and he is now telling the other Christians, don't accept them. If you accept them, I'm going to excommunicate you. I'm going to throw you out of the church. He is using his position to establish fear among the members so that these members would follow him in his pride, in his criticism, in his isolation. He wanted to dictate to other believers not to do what is right. And that's very, very sad. That's very, very sad. The last person we want to talk about today is by the person Demetrius. Demetrius. Look at 3 John verse 12. Demetrius is well spoken of by everyone and even by the truth itself. We also speak well of him, and you know that our testimony is true. We don't know much about Demetrius. The Bible is silent about why John was speaking well of Demetrius, why everyone was speaking well of Demetrius. We don't know what he's done that he deserved this kind of reception by everyone. We don't know. The Bible is silent. But one thing I want us to focus about Demetrius is this. He was well spoken by everyone, meaning to say general public. Everyone was speaking well of him. Let me clarify. Everyone speaking well of you doesn't mean that you are that it is good. Let me repeat that. Everyone speaking well of you doesn't mean that it is good. Just because everyone is speaking well of you doesn't mean that you're doing what's right. It could simply mean that you are a people pleaser, one who follows the crowd. But Demetrius' life is in accord with the truth of the Word of God. And that's why Demetrius is not simply pleasing people in order to gain their reception, but rather he's someone who's living in the truth and showing everyone that in spite of the fact that I am living according to the Word of God, I can still be of good reputation to everyone. A lot of Christians, they feel that if I live by the truth, everyone will hate me. And I have to choose whether I want to please people or I want to live my life according to the truth. The problem is because these Christians, they are very abrasive. They go around telling people that homosexuality is an abomination in the eyes of God. And for them, they're just proclaiming the truth. And yet the Bible tells us you don't have to be that abrasive. You don't have to be that aggressive. You don't go around telling people or condemning people in their sin, especially if they're not believers. You can learn to love sinners without compromising the truth. And what John is saying here, you can actually be well spoken of without compromising the truth. That is possible pala. Okay? That is possible pala. Look at what the Bible says. Demetrius, he was well spoken by everyone, general public. He was also well spoken of by the apostles, the people in authority, or at least in spiritual authority. Everyone was speaking well of him. But more importantly, the third point that I want us to understand, he was well spoken of by the truth. His life was in accord with the truth. That everyone who saw see him knew that he, although he was well spoken of, he was also a man of truth. That living according to truth can also be a boost to your reputation. It doesn't have to be contrary to each other. And that's why we have to be reminded, a good testimony is very important, especially among unbelievers. A good testimony is very, very important. Gaius had that. Gaius had a very good reputation. He has a very good testimony. And now we find Demetrius also the same way. He was a man who was well spoken of by everyone. And they continue to live according to the truth. And yet people continue to praise them because it's possible to live according to the truth and be well liked by the people. Verse 13 to 14, I have the Apostle John ends his letter with a friendly outpouring of his heart. He was saying, I have much to write to you, but I do not want to do so with pen and ink. I hope to see you soon, and we will talk face to face. Peace to you. The friends here send their greetings. Greet the friends there by name. Now, I want us to focus in one verse that I jump over, verse 11. And probably this is the main point of this whole book. It says, dear friend, do not imitate what is evil, but do what is good. Anyone who does what is good is from God. Anyone who does what is evil has not seen God. My sisters, let me put it this way. In any church that you go to, there will always be a Gaius, there will always be a Diotrephes, there will always be a Demetrius. And the Bible tells us, yes, these people will be a part of our church life. The important point for us, we learn who we ought to imitate. Do not imitate people who are like Diotrephes. Do not be like them. Rather, be like Gaius. Be like Demetrius. Live in such a way that you will be well spoken of without having to compromise the truth. Do not be like Diotrephes, who although he knows the truth, didn't live out the truth, was not hospitable, shut his door to those who are in need, especially these missionaries who were traveling from one city to another. Brothers and sisters, John is reminding us. In 2 John, he's reminding us, do not support everyone. Only support those who are in the truth. And when we come to 3 John, 3 John is telling us, do not be stingy. Open your doors. Help those missionaries who needs help. Because by doing so, you are partnering with them in their work. My sisters, imitate what is good, not what is evil. Learn from Gaius, learn from Demetrius. Live a life that is according to the truth, continue in truth, and continue to learn how to love one another. And make sure that our testimonies will always be blameless in the eyes of God and even in the eyes of men. My sisters, again, there will be Diotrephes in our churches. And the Bible reminds us, these people, they will be very divisive. These people, they will be critical of everything. These people, they will be very self-centered. Be careful about them. Be careful about them, but at the same time, continue to reach out to them. They may continue to cause conflicts, but learn to love them and bring them to the right side. Do not imitate them. Continue doing what is good. Because anyone who does what is good, that is a sign that you are from God. And anyone who continues to do what is evil, they don't really know God. And that's why I say that there's a very big chance that Diotrephes was not even a believer in the first place, even though he was a church leader by this time. Sisters, learn from Gaius, learn from Demetrius. The lesson of 3 John, imitate what is good. What is good? Balance your truth with love. Balance your truth with love. Because a lot of times when we keep focusing on the truth, when we focus on what is right, a lot of times we become impatient. A lot of times we become judgmental. A lot of times we become critical. If we don't have love. If we don't have love. 1 Corinthians chapter 13 tells us that even if we can speak in tongues of angels and of men, even if you know all knowledge, all mysteries, but if you do not have love, then you are just simply a sounding gong, a clanging cymbal. You are just simply making noise with all your truth. You are simply making noises. Brothers and sisters, making noise is annoying. Making noise is painful to the ears. Learn to love. Learn to love. Balance your truth with love. And it's my prayer that as a church, we will continue to grow in truth, we will continue to grow in love, and that we will continue to balance love with truth and truth with love, that they will always go hand in hand so that we will be effective and productive in the Lord. May God continue to bless His word. Why don't we come to the Lord in prayer this morning? Father, we thank you. We thank you because indeed, Father, if we look back upon our life, someone gave. Someone supported the pastor. Someone paid for the pastor. Someone paid for the missionary. And that's why we are able to hear of the gospel. That's why we are now part of the church. Father, we thank you, Father, for those who partnered with this pastor. Even though they themselves didn't share the gospel with us, Father, we still are indebted to them because they gave. And because they gave, they partnered in the work of the gospel in our lives. Father, we thank you, Father, for them. It is my prayer that you bless these people who were instrumental for the pastor to be able to come and preach the word to us. It is also our prayer, Father, that as a church, we will continue to have this mindset, to continue to support our missionaries, to continue to support our pastors who have been instrumental in teaching us the word of God and instrumental in our spiritual walk with you. That we will never forget how to be supportive of their work so that we can also partner with them in the ministry. But Father, it is my prayer in our desire to help missionaries and pastors. Help us to be discerning. Help us to understand which ones deserve our help. Because indeed, if we are not careful, we may actually be helping someone spread or start a cult or spread falsehood. Father, it is our prayer that we would be vigilant before we support these missionaries or these pastors. Father, in our personal capacity, it is my prayer that we will continue to live a life that is of good reputation, that everywhere we go, our testimony will always be one that is well accepted by the people, that people will know us to be someone who is like Christ because of how we live our life. Forgive us, Father, if a lot of times our testimony have been far from exemplary. Forgive us, Father, if we allow our anger to get the better of us. We allow our greed, our ambitions, our desire to avoid hassle, that we bribe the policemen, that we bribe the officials. And in doing so, Father, we destroy our testimony and our reputation to other people. Forgive us, Lord. Forgive us if every time we preach the gospel, it has been muddied because of our testimony, that people would not believe in you because of how we live our lives. It is my prayer that you would open up our eyes to see our life as it is, that we may make the right corrections, that your Holy Spirit would continue to prompt us to make changes. And by the power of Jesus Christ, we would continue to live a life that is one moving towards Christ's likeness more and more. Father, we thank you. We continue to pray for our church. Indeed, Father, we pray that you would continue to bless us, Father, with a church building so that one day we can have a community and we can continue to reach out to the community around us, Father, with your truth. Father, indeed, although we are supposed to be settlers, we don't have a home where we can settle in. And it's my prayer, Father, that you continue to be the one to provide for us, that we could be able to purchase our own a lot where we can actually build our own building and be able to minister to the people in that community. Father, we continue to commit each one of us into your hands, O Lord. Bless us and continue to give us a good and godly week ahead of us, that wherever we go, we can continue to be your channels of love, channels of grace, that when people see us, they will continue to see Christ in us. This is my prayer for your glory and for your name. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen and amen. Brothers, our worship service ends here. Allow me to share some announcements with all of us again. We will be celebrating our Christmas party on December 12th. I will be posting a link probably next Sunday. At the end of our worship service, there will be a link that we will be posting. Please copy that link, or rather, we'll be posting it on YouTube as a comment on the comment section. You will find a link where you can click on and register for our Christmas party. We need you to register so that we would know how much we need to how much food we need to prepare to send to everyone. And we also need your addresses and how many people will be attending this Christmas party in your household. So please take note of this. Next week, we will be putting a link. Please get into the link and register yourself and your family members who wants to join in our Christmas party for December 12. We will have games, we will have activities, we will have special numbers, and hopefully we can gather together in Zoom and just simply have fellowship. I know that we've been using Zoom for Bible studies, for worship service, and usually when we do our Bible studies or even worship service on YouTube, we don't have that much interaction. Hopefully that this Christmas party, we would be able to have a true-to-goodness fellowship where we can actually interact with one another and simply have fun as we remember the birth of Christ this December. Once again, I'd like to invite everyone to click the link and register yourself and your family members. Once again, have a blessed and godly week ahead of you. God bless each and everyone.